Older than you, seriously. Thank you for the invite, and I bring you greetings from Paya Methodist Church, yeah, church where we are presently at. Shall we go to God in prayer? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this time. I just wait upon you, Father God, to ask that you just come into this place. It's all about you. We ask again for that fresh touch from you. Holy Spirit, this is your time. Would you quicken your word to our spirit? Apart from you, we know we can do nothing. And so, Holy Spirit, come and reveal Jesus to us. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As Pastor Lynette shared, I work in the school ministry. So presently, I'm posted at St. Francis Methodist School. It's a very challenging school. It's an international Methodist school, yeah. So usually I just speak about like for 10 minutes. Any longer for chapel, if I speak any longer, I'm just talking to myself, yeah. But for today, we'll see how it goes. I'm gonna start with something a little lighthearted, because this is a very challenging message, okay? The theme is on challenges, taken from Psalm 46. But just for a start, we'll look at something lighthearted, the challenge that even a dog faces.
Look, no more messing around. Let's get super serious about this right now. You got this. It's too easy. Four, Clark? You're a madman!
See how strong this dog is in the face of challenge.
Yeah. You're just showing off. Smell beef? You're crazy!
Resilient dog, yeah? Ultimate.
Okay, Clark.
That's strength of discipline. Nothing can shatter this dog. Yay! Okay. Okay, just something fun and lighthearted, because the message is very serious. Okay, so as I was... Alright, so challenges. I'm sure. I'm sure it's not new to us, the challenges that we're facing all around us, terrorism and climate change and the latest virus attack and the terrorism. So we are very familiar with challenges, yeah. And so even for some of us, maybe closer to home, we are also facing personal challenges, maybe family relationships, maybe health issues, or even work stress. So challenges is something we are constantly facing, whether at the world front or just home front, yeah? And so just think with me for the last week as you perhaps face a challenge of some sort, or you just read the newspaper and you see the turmoil. What has been your emotions like, right? Would it have been disgust or anger, or you just don't care, you know, tida apa, or maybe fear gripped you, you couldn't sleep, yeah? Or has it been quiet, strong, sturdy faith, and you know, you are unshakable? And so today, as we think about this theme about challenges, I just want us to just think about this question: what does God want to be for me in the midst of these challenges, right? We're going to look at Psalms 46, and this is taken from the Passion Translation. Yeah, Passion Translation. Let's read it together. Ready, go. God, you're such a safe and powerful place to find refuge. You're a proven help in times of trouble, more than enough and always available whenever I need you. So we will never fear, even if every structure of support were to crumble away. We will not fear even when the earth quakes and shakes, moving mountains and casting them into the sea. For the raging roar of stormy winds and crashing waves cannot erode our faith in you. Pause in his presence. God has a constantly flowing river whose sparkling streams bring joy and delight to his people. His river flows right through the city of God Most High and into his dwelling places. God is in the midst of his city, secure and never shaken. At daybreak, his help will be seen with the appearing of the dawn. When the nations are in uproar with their torturing kingdoms, God simply raises his voice and the earth begins to disintegrate before him. Here he comes, the commander, the mighty Lord of angel armies is on our side. The God of Jacob fights for us. Pause in his presence. Everyone look, come and see the breathtaking wonders of our God. For he brings both ruin and revival. He's the one who makes conflicts end throughout the earth, breaking and burning every weapon of war. Surrender your anxiety, be silent, and stop your striving, and you will see that I am God. I am the God above all the nations, and I will be exalted throughout the whole earth. Here he stands, the commander, the mighty Lord of angel armies is on our side. The God of Jacob fights for us. Pause in his presence. Let me just do a quick brief overview and I'll just highlight two verses. So the first verse, it says, God, you're in such a safe and powerful place to find refuge. And just we remember that this psalm begins with the presence of God in our midst, right? And then in verse 2 and verse 3, immediately we are brought into the stark reality of the horrors of earthquakes, natural disasters. So I've themed this 2 and 3 as natural disasters, right? Mountains moving, crashing into the sea, things like the tsunami, the earthquake, the all the storms crashing and the waves crashing, all right? So that's natural disaster. And then verse 4 and verse 5, we turn back into the presence of God again. It focuses once again into the presence of God. God has a constantly moving river, and God is in the midst of the city, right? His presence is there. And then verse 6, again, it brings us back again into the reality. The nations are in uproar with torturing kingdoms. So once again, we're looking at what's happening around us in the world, and it's not a pretty scene, right? So there's political turmoil there. Verse 7, verse 8, verse 9, I just themed a simple theme as God's deliverance. So once again, we see God in action. He's doing something and he's taking control and he's fighting for us, right? And then verse 10, a very familiar verse, I think all of us are familiar with, to be still and to know that he is God. God is sovereign, we are reminded. He's moving and he is God above all heavens and earth, right? And then verse 11, once again, I've just themed it simply as God's presence with us again. God is with us, he fights for us, he is the victory, right? So just look at a very simple, brief overview at the way Psalms 46 is written. It's very interesting, I thought, that it begins with God's presence, verse 1. And then verse 4 and 5, it refers us back to God's presence again. And then from verse 11 and 7 to 11, we referred back to God's presence again, all right? God is the final victory. But sandwiched in between verse 1, verse 4, and verse 5, we focus on the reality. And the reality around us, the facts that we see around us will be the natural disaster. Verse 6, there's political turmoil. And so that's what it is like for us in this world. As Christians, right, we know that, my goodness, you know, the world around us is in a mess. And if we focus on that, you know, our lives will not be on the right track. And so this psalm reminds us again that we need to just shift to the reality, from the reality into the truth. And the truth is that God is with us. So the fact, when you open the newspaper, you read the facts. You read the bomb disaster, you read the turmoil, you read the natural disaster, you read all the calamities. Those are facts. Bible doesn't deny the facts. But then when you look into God's Word, when you go back into your quiet time, when you come for prayer and worship, we need to shift from fact to truth. And we need to let that truth dominate and be what we want to anchor our faith in, all right? The truth in Psalms 46 repeatedly reminds us, hey, shift back to the fact that God's presence is in the midst of all these disasters and calamities, right? Verse 7 to 11 emphasizes again, you know, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We know the end from the beginning, that God is victorious. He will see us through, and that's what it's all about, right? So what does God want to be for me in the midst of these challenges? So let's look at it close up, okay? So I'm just going to highlight two verses. The first point I want to make is the blessings of God. Verse 4 says, God has a constantly flowing river whose sparkling streams bring joy and delight to His people. So in the midst of the calamity, verse 2 and verse 3, if you just focus on that, it will be the disaster scene. Imagine if a tsunami just took place. And so your mind will be filled with all the destruction and the ruins and catastrophe. It's a horrible scene. Or just imagine if over Easter, this church was bombed. You know, it's not in Sri Lanka, but it's Aldersgate Methodist Church. It was bombed on Easter Sunday. And you came to church and you looked at the disaster. I'm sure mentally, emotionally, probably we won't be able to take it. It's messy. It's hard. It's difficult. But that's what happened to the church in Sri Lanka, right? They came to church and then they saw the whole church completely destroyed. It's real. But then in verse 4, the first 4 reverts immediately and says, God has a constantly flowing river. So in the midst of that natural disaster or whatever disaster you may be facing, in this context, God reveals to us, Himself to us, as a constantly flowing river. It's a beautiful scene. So imagine if you just came through, you visited the church that was destroyed by the bombing, and you went and sat in the presence of God. It will be really hard to draw close to God if that was what was occupying your mind, you know, all the destruction. And so God comes to us and say, don't focus on that. Shift to the river. Shift your imagination, shift it to something positive, who He wants to be for us. You know, sometimes God reveals Himself to us differently for different people in different times, right? When Moses had to face Pharaoh, Moses says, God, how do I tell people, you know, about You? And so God just told him, just tell them that I am, right? I am who I am. Just words. I am who I am. But in this situation, God says He's revealing Himself to us in the midst of disaster and catastrophe. He says, I am a constantly flowing river. How beautiful, isn't it? If your mind is filled with anxiety and just a scene that is very awful, and then suddenly, you know, God says, shift over and focus on Me and see Me as a constantly flowing river, a river that's sparkling, a river that brings joy and delight to you. And I think if we can shift that imagination, we will be able to focus on the truth that God wants us to dwell on His provision, His blessings, even in the midst of disaster and difficulty. Yeah, this river theme is found in many places in the Bible. So just want to quickly just share with you the river in Isaiah 43:19. God says, I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So the desert is there. Those are the trying times, the difficult times. But God says, I will make a river in the desert. Right? He will bring us refreshment in the difficult situation. Ezekiel 47 verse 9 says, swarms of living creatures will live wherever the river flows. There will be large numbers of fish because this water flows there and makes the salt water fresh. So where the river flows, everything will live. And so in this situation, the river changes the environment, doesn't it? Okay, from salt water to fresh water. And so in your office, in your school, in your family, wherever there is darkness or depression or negative speech or the mood is just not good, right? It's just negative. Allow God to use you to be that river to bring a change in the environment from darkness to light. Ask God to use you to speak life instead of negative words. Right? In terms of rejection to rejoicing, in terms of confusion to calm, in terms of despair to hope to destiny. His river in you will flow through you to change the environment, to change the atmosphere. Right? In Isaiah 48:18, it says, if only you had paid attention to my commands, your peace would have been like a river, your well-being like the waves of the sea. So God wants to come to us like a river that brings peace. And not just, you know, to our minds, but to our entire being. It says here in this verse, your well-being like the waves of the sea. He wants to just flow and fill us and overflow a mighty moving force like the waves of the sea. He's concerned about every part of us, our well-being, right? Not just the spiritual part, but every area in our lives, our family life, our study life, our work life, right? And finally, this very famous passage as well, Revelation 22:1, the angel showed me the river of the water of life. That's who God wants to be for us, right? This river of life. Filling us, giving us the hope we need for whatever we are facing in life, and bringing life wherever we go, right? So He's that river of life, of refreshment, of change, of peace. He's just a good God. He cares about our well-being. Just a very simple illustration of a God who is constantly blessing us in every area of our lives. We just need to tune our hearts and minds to look out for where the blessing of God is in every challenge that we face. Yeah. Many years ago, we went to do our postgraduate studies in US. Our daughter at that time was 8 years old, and we had just settled in America, and it was like the third week where we had arrived, and we were just taking a drive along the highway just after church service, I remembered. And then suddenly we saw, about an hour's drive from where we lived, we saw this Singapore-Malaysia restaurant. And that's Jonathan's hobby, yeah? He loves to eat. And so, wow, he was so excited. I said, okay, you know, in America, you see a Singapore-Malaysian restaurant. You just wonder what is it like there. And so we drove and we went in. And lo and behold, when we arrived there, we bump into this couple. This couple, the husband, was a classmate of ours, studied in TTC but we haven't seen him for the last 10 years. And so we bump into him in America, of all places, found out that he's married, he's got a Taiwanese wife. And of course, in the course of our conversation, he said, oh, you know, we're actually looking for a Chinese tutor for our daughter. So, I mean, to be very honest, we were not really the kiasu parents, lah. We didn't really like pray. We just had this, you know, okay, what to do with our daughter's Chinese education. But the Lord is so good, you know. Even before we prayed, ta-da, He presented this couple, and the wife is a Taiwanese. So she said, oh, I can teach your daughter, no problem, it's free of charge, yeah. And so for that year in US, in New Jersey, we had free Chinese tuition for our 8-year-old daughter. And that's the kind of God we have, you know. I think Jonathan and I were laughing because we just can't imagine that God is so detailed. He even brings a Chinese tutor for my daughter right in the heart of America, and right just when we were looking for Singapore food. I mean, this is the kind of God we serve, right? He's incredible. He's just beyond words. So God is good. God is good. He blesses us in everything we go through. Second point is the presence of God. So in verse 5, the verse says, God is in the midst of his city, secure and never shaken. In verse 4, God reveals himself to us as a river that is flowing. And that talks about the blessings. When we see the blessings of God, we sense the heart of God for us, the love of God, the character of God. My goodness, God, you even care about my daughter's Chinese tuition and provided a free tuition teacher, you know, in America. Wow, you know, God, you're so good, right? So we sense that character of God, that he cares, a God of details, a God who knows our needs even before we ask. But in verse 5, God says, I am in your midst. Not just the blessings are so good, but more than the blessings, the verse 5 tells us, God is in our midst. God says, I am with you. And of course, blessings are great, but more important than blessings is the very presence of God himself. And that's the cry of our hearts, isn't it? God, I love you for the things you've done for me. But God, there's so much more to you that I need to know and I want to know and I want to experience. And I think God in verse 5 wants us to know that too. He makes it so explicit, just in case we didn't get it, that he is the God who provided all these blessings. He says, ta-da, you know, I am with you. I am here. I am in your midst, right? And that's the heart of the Christian faith, is to have a relationship with God. It's not about religion. It's not about duty and routine and doing the right things. It's really at the heart of it is to have a relationship with this God, right? And so God says he wants to have a relationship with us in the midst of our challenges, whatever we are going through. I've put a picture here of this footprints in the sand. I'm sure you're all familiar with it, right? So the writer writes in this story that there's two sets of footprints. And at the darkest point in this person's life, he says, where were you, God? You know, there's only one set of footprints. And of course, God spoke to the author and said, you know, in your darkest moment, there's only one set of footprints because I was carrying you, right? And so I think that's a good reminder for us, because in the darkest times, that's where we are challenged to really believe that God is real, he cares, he's with us, and he's for us. I'm sure you're familiar with these verses about God's presence being with us. Hebrews 13:5 says, never will I leave you, nor will I forsake you. Matthew 28:20, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Psalm 75:1, we praise you, God. We praise you for your name is near. People tell of your wonderful deeds. So if God repeats so many times to tell us in so many ways in his word from beginning to end that he is with us, he is near us, why is it that we question God and we ask, God, where are you? God, do you know? God, are you even real? And those are valid questions. I've asked those questions too in my challenging times. And I think even as I share with you, I realize that the enemy is really the one telling the lie. Whenever you feel alone, that's a lie. Because the Word of God tells us the truth that he is present. He's not even 1 second away from you. He is real. So when you hear the lie of the enemy whispering into your ear, maybe on a night when you're alone or a time when you're alone, you are not alone. That's the lie of the devil. Bible tells us he is with us. He never leaves us nor forsake us. Right? God is closer than you think. These are the writings found on the Auschwitz concentration camp. I'm sure you're familiar with the event that happened where 6 million Jews were killed. And these writings, I thought, speaks so clearly to us in our own times of challenge, right? It says, I believe in the sun even when it is not shining. I believe in love even when I'm alone. I believe in God even when He is silent. Even in the midst of tragic circumstances, God is still present, even when it is hard to see or perceive Him. I love these words so much because it is so true that in times when we don't see God, we cannot feel God, when God is silent and when prayers are not answered, we know, even as this writing states so clearly, God is still present. I want to share with you about this this missionary couple, someone whom I do follow quite a bit and listen to his sermons. He's from YWAM. They're a YWAM couple serving God for many, many years in Africa. Just about 3 years or so ago, Floyd, who is a Bible teacher, man of God, loves his teachings. He was just struck down with a virus that caused him to be bedridden, and now he apparently cannot even talk. So he's just lying in bed for the last 3 years or so. His wife, who partners with him in ministry in Africa, she was also struck with cancer, and when in fact, she had it even before him. And in the midst of his sickness, she had a relapse of her cancer too. And I do read her blogs quite a lot because it's really encouraging for those of us who may face challenges and personal difficulties and trials. Her writings are really, really encouraging and very powerful because she's writing from an experience of overcoming, right, or standing and believing in God for that breakthrough. And this is what she says. The truth is that we are often so focused on the pain that we miss God's presence. He's right with us, closer than the air we breathe. And yet our pain overshadows the very thing, the very person we need. So she's constantly encouraging us, reminding us that God is real, even in the midst of her own challenge, right? In one of her writings, she also quotes this mother who is going through a difficult time. She said that she has 3 keys for how to make it through the challenges. Stay in His presence, written by this mother. Stand on His word and rejoice. Rejoicing is the voice of faith, isn't it? It's hard to rejoice in the midst of challenges. So really, faith, praise, rejoicing is a voice of faith in the midst of our challenges. So the final point is God's breakthrough. This verse here, verse 5 says, God is in the midst of His city, secure and never shaken. At daybreak, His help will be seen with the appearing of the dawn. This comes from God's word. God tells us He's in our midst, He's at work, and then He says, in His time, at daybreak. We don't know when daybreak is for all of us in our own situation. It may be tomorrow, it may be next week, it may be next month, it may be next year, it may be when Jesus comes. I don't know. But the word of God tells us, His promise is that at daybreak, His help will be seen with the appearing of dawn. That's our hope, right? The God of the breakthrough. Psalms 30 verse 5 puts it this way, His anger lasts only a moment, but His favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning, right? So God will bring us that breakthrough in His time. I'm sure you're all very familiar with Romans 8:28. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. And that's the promise of God, that He will work it out for good. It will be His best for us. Let's watch this video.
I grew up in a middle-income family, and when I was born a few months later, what I came to know was that actually my dad left the family. I never seen my dad, as long as I have any kind of recollection or memory. But my idea of a family unit would comprise of my mom, my 2 brothers, and myself. I think because I didn't get to see my dad, I felt a little bit abandoned and I felt unwanted. So I often question like whether my parents even wanted me to be around. And in addition, when my brothers decided to leave the house when I was 5 years old, it kind of like reinforced that mindset that, you know, I'm not important enough for people to stay. The first time I met my dad, I think what I remember very vividly was him apologizing. I saw it in his eyes. He was very sincere. I was 15 at that time, so I felt like even though I was so young, but I was at a crossroads of deciding, you know, whether I would continue to live in a life of hatred or to live in a life of being able to, you know, give this a second chance. I actually came across a quote that says something along the lines of, to forgive is to set a prisoner free, and then to find out that actually the prisoner was you. And I think that was something that resonates a lot with me, because I discovered that what really weighed me down over the years, that sense of bitterness and anger, stemmed from the fact that I couldn't forgive. And when I started to take baby steps towards learning how to forgive them, and I would say that even forgiveness is still ongoing today, I learned to see that actually it helps me to have a new lease of life, in a sense, and also to have a new way of and appreciating these family ties that I have.
It's not something that we planned, that we'll be working in the same office. I started out as a volunteer and later I joined as staff. It seems a little bit strange because, you know, I've not seen her for so long, and then trying to get to know her personality, what she likes, what she doesn't like, trying to know her in a little more intimate way as well, like to understand our emotions and having those questions that were unanswered all these years, and just be able to process it together with her.
I would say a very beautiful orchestration, because we ended up working on the same project and carrying the same heartbeat for young people. And even though we didn't have a chance to grow up together, but being able to work towards a common goal now is something that I treasure. And I think through the process of working together, we came to know each other better as well. If you ask me when I was age 10 years old whether or not I believe in family, I would say no. But having journeyed through, experiencing the breakthroughs for myself, I would tell others that, you know, it is worth fighting for, and the joy that you get from restored relationships is something that, yeah, you know, it's worth it.
So just to conclude, even in the midst of challenges, we can learn to see God's blessings. We know that God is present and God is at work. He's showing us, yeah, in His perfect time, He will give us that breakthrough. Even as we've seen how Delia moved from a broken family and then eventually forgiving her father, and then working together with a brother and restoring that relationship. It's so beautiful. Really, it's only God can do such a thing like that. So we want to continue to just press on and believe God is at work in all our lives, in every situation. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you. And no matter what we will face in the future, or even presently, the challenges each of us are going through, whether at work, at home, or in the countries that we are seeing in our midst, Lord, we just want to declare, Father God, that your word is true, your promise is true, that you are with us at every moment of the day. We just need to shift our minds and our focus and focus on the truth that you are in our midst. And so we thank you, Father God, that you are the conqueror and you're more than a conqueror and you are with us, you are in us. We can put our faith and trust in you. Help us know that we are never, ever, ever alone. You will never, ever leave us or forsake us. We thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.